I have a little role of just thanking our sponsor, and then I get to sit in the, yep. in the panel. I don't get to moderate the panel today, so I answer questions. But for those of you who don't know, this Jueves Professional Talk is sponsored by Ministerio de Trabajo, the labor ministry in Spain. And they take place once a month, and Merced and Rocio are doing a fantastic job organizing great panelists and very interesting venues, little drinks and tapas, and it's always fun to join these events. So please always come over. I'm going to introduce Angelika very briefly. She is an independent professional, consultant who specializes in supporting entrepreneurs in everything that an entrepreneur needs to do. She's also a co-founder of the SV Latin American Fund.
Right, SV Latin Fund. We invest in Latin American companies.
And with that, I give you the word.
We just got the original funding from INADEM, Instituto Nacional de Emprendedores, and we're continuing. I'm also mentored 500 startups and Singularity Labs, etc. So even though my background is totally different, this is my passion. I'd like you to each introduce yourself for 2 seconds. I can't stand events where you have the bios and then you read the bios.
That's right.
Right? So we're not going to do that. The other thing we'll do is I'll ask a couple of questions. I'm not sure if we formatted them for the right level. Normally, since I meet a lot of Spanish entrepreneurs, they all ask me the same thing. And the most important one is, how do I meet investors? Where do I find them, etc. So if the level of the questions that we've prepared are too low, we have quite a lot and we can zoom right along. Tell us, do feel free to raise your hand. This is a dialogue. This isn't a university lecture, but we're here really to answer your questions. And so it's important that we hit that, right, on the head.
So I'm Julio Casal. I'm founder of Ilimbo. And also a venture partner. After Ilimbo, I started a bit of my time in a venture capital. It's called Adara. And I'm also now starting a new startup. So I'm pretty busy right now. So I don't know if I should explain a little bit about my background in Ilimbo, or should wait a little bit.
I did want him to, because he's kind of the classic example of a Spaniard who made good and he had very different circumstances, so please do.
Some people already have heard about it.
You want to hear it? That's okay, they'll listen to it again. They'll listen to it again, right?
Once again, so I think it's a very good example, as Angelika was saying, of a complete journey. That means a very small Spanish startup. It is based in Madrid, founded in the year 2007. 40,000 euro, so that's two people. A very, very small office in Guadilla in Madrid. So then, and all the way up to, it's a very well established right now, Silicon Valley, US company. So we did, talking about funding, so we did, year 2009, we did angel round that was around 250K.
Which is pretty amazing if you think there was the international crisis in 2008. So, wow.
Yeah, well, that was friends and family. So that's
still.
Fools, friends and family. I don't know what was that. So, that was year 2009. 2010, we did our first Series A with Adara, which is the fund I'm now. That was around 1 million euro. We had some of our friends, like Antonio works in Teldat is an industrial IT company, a very good company in Spain, so they also put up a good chunk of the run. And then we relocated. We moved from the founders, we relocated ourselves, our families, our houses, everything, to Silicon Valley, year 2010, end of year 2010. Everything went very well, we can explain later. Then, year 2011 we did Trident Capital, Series B, that was around $12 million. Year 2012 we did Climate Protein and Sigma, Series C, that was around $23 million. And year 2013 we did Sigma, Intel and some others, another $23-24 million. So that was pretty 4 years, four rounds, pretty good run. Then the launch of Americans came. I was CEO. I'm not CEO anymore, obviously. But I'm very happy, by the way. So that's something they can't understand, but the truth is this is a really well-established American company. It's in San Mateo, maybe 40, 50 big execs. The board is very well-established. And most of that second part of success, not, it's not my credit, it's the credit of the partners that I was able to start with. In fact, the first one was Trident, Alberto Yepta, which is a guy, well-known guy. So that was absolutely key for me. I think we did good the first part of the journey, but that second, which is the American, I mean, when we came here, we knew zero persons, not just one, zero, nothing. We knew nobody. So obviously, you need to open the gates of Silicon Valley, which is a very well closed, in my opinion, it's very rich, very, very, very rich, but it's not open typically to everybody. No, it's very endogamic. It's very endogamic.
I don't agree with you. If I think about, so I'm from Germany, if I think you're trying to get to Germans or French,
in the sense of the venture capitalists, I think that
getting funded.
It's really difficult. I mean, you need many parameters. Yeah. In fact, you need to be, in my opinion, US-based company at least. Well, yeah. There was a big problem.
Oh yeah. Except Dave McClure, it's still that way. Instead of besides 500 startups, you still have to.
And you need the IP here. I mean, many. Very specific things there. And typically you need to be well known and you need contacts. And so that's how I see funding working. It's a lot about who you are, who do you know, what have you done. And so the thing is, if you come here and you know nobody, how the hell do you break that vice cycle? So anyway, it's been great for me, and I think it's very different, the venture capital world from here, from the Spain. It's totally different context, totally different. Way they operate, the way they negotiate, the way they behave, the way they help you, the way. And so happy to talk about that.
Greg and Mar, welcome. This is where I work, so this is our space. And I've been in this industry for 20 years, so that's a really long time. And I came here to Stanford to get my PhD, and I did electrical engineering. And after that, I started two companies, so I raised a bunch of money, sold them, and I worked at a public company running engineering, and finally I made it to venture. And now we have a $50 million fund. We invest in early and seed stage, and we Series A as well. And we use this space to create community. Both my partner and I believe in giving back. So part of the thing that we want to do is have people talk to each other and help people that don't have, you know, those connections or that help get started. And, you know, you're all welcome to come here when you're in Palo Alto, for sure.
Great. So thank you also, and thank you, Abby, for hosting us here. And now we know that we have a nice space that we can use for in Palo Alto.
Yes, exactly.
It's always difficult to find something so low-key, you know, not just corporate
things. This is
beautiful. Entrepreneurs like.
It's better when there's people inside.
Well, not when they're here too. But anyway, you know me. I work also as an independent consultant supporting entrepreneurs, mostly on the fundraising process. And I always say fundraising is not just knocking on doors and getting the money. It is a lot of strategy in preparation to make sure that your product and your product is your company fits what your buyers want, which is your investors. So making that fit, there is a lot of strategy that needs to take place. I spend probably 2/3 of my time working on that with the entrepreneurs I work with. I take the role of CFO or any role one day a week, and I'm become part of the company for at least 2 years, if not more, preferably more. And I become basically a Silicon Valley partner as a land CEO. All my clients are from overseas, and two from Spain. One is Visualnet in LA. The other one is Luday. Some of you know Eneco. I'm his CFO as well. And I've got a client from Canada and a client from China. And anybody who needs help, I'm very happy to talk to you. And I enjoy my time talking to any entrepreneur and anybody who lands here. Had fun talking to the folks from Spain Tech Center, who are here today. And I live in this area, so as long as you want to have a coffee with me in Café Borrone, I'm there with you.
See, and I have a PhD too, but not in one of these great areas. That's why I'm the moderator, and they're the real So how many of you already have funding? Of a startup. How many are looking? Okay. So the rest of you are just here for to kind of have an idea of what's going on.
Sorry?
They're
investors.
They will be
looking. Oh, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Because again, because I meet so many Spaniards that want to know basic question, we sort of prepared a lot of basic ones, but you know, if you're saying this is really basic, sort of raise your hand and say, move on to something else. Or you ask your questions. I just want to make sure. I hate that when people come to Silicon Valley and they say, Google was founded by Larry Page and Sergey Brin. And you keep wondering, you know, where do you think you are? Have you been to these kind of presentations that are really low level? Well, I have. So the first question that everyone asks me, and I mean, it's not everyone going to answer every question. Jump in, and if anyone disagrees, say so, is really, how do you meet investors? A lot of people think, I'll meet them, introduce me to one, or I'll meet them at an event or her, and then I'll email, I'll do cold call, I'll do emails to all the investors that there are, all the VCs, and then, it, you know, the percentage of 100, you know, 2% answer, so obviously that doesn't work. Who wants to take that first?
I'll give you my view. I moved to Menlo Park because that's where the money is. Always you look at me. Why do you rob banks and not something else? Because that's where the money is. I moved here. I believe that investors like you are part of the community. You're not just one deal or one acquaintance. They want to know you for good, and they want to know you a little bit beyond your project.
But how do you do that? So you say Juan Fulano Gital, and you get there.
Three methods. One, attend any conferences where the VCs are speaking. When they finish speaking, get in line in front of them and get a card. Say something so they remember your face. Following day, you connect and you say, we spoke yesterday.
You send an email.
I send email. And okay. I said, we told you, asked me to send you something, I'd like to have a coffee with you, and try to get them to have a coffee with you.
What's the chance you'll say yes?
50-50.
Okay.
50-50. Depends on how your project excited him or not.
Exactly.
If it's totally out of his scope, he'll say no.
Yeah.
If it's not, if it's in scope, then
yeah.
I would say get an intro from somebody. I think we have so many people reaching out that it's,
exactly.
I would want to see everybody that comes, but there's literally no more time
chairs in front of
in a day. So, you know, the best thing, the emails that we reply to with 100% is somebody that gets introduced by somebody we know.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, luckily there's like LinkedIn today and there's Facebook and there's all these things. So if you do a little bit of homework, probably there's somebody that, you know, is connected to somebody else that can at least make some sort of introduction. So that's how we at least do the first part of filtering. Absolutely, you know, you can be very aggressive and, you know, I think the Uber guys got money because they literally got into a taxi with an investor. So, you know, so you can be like that and then you're very memorable because they'll remember you as a crazy person.
But there's a point. I have a French friend who will go as a VC. They fall into the bathroom. Literally. That's not the way to go. How did you know he was French? Did I say he was French?
Yeah,
I did. Okay.
And you know, a lot has changed, I think, in the last 5 years, I would say, about venture and meeting people. You know, it used to be that venture people would be in their mansions in Atherton, and they would never go to a coffee place, they would never have events to invite people, and I think that has changed dramatically in the last 5 years. Everybody's blogging about anything possible, and they want you to reach out to them. So I think there are a lot more opportunities to meet people, more conferences, everything. Much more open.
So, I'll give you my experience. I don't have all the experience that you have, but what happened to me, when I was in Spain, I did a round in Europe. So I had a business banker, so like 20 venture capitalists in London, France, mm-hmm. Switzerland, whatever. Mm-hmm. Then all of them were super nice and super good, but nobody gave me a dollar. Super elegant and super, you know. And then, so what happened is then, I was finishing, and then we found in the street Adara, and the guy was in my office, was in very close to his office in Madrid, no? So that in 1 month I got a dollar. I didn't pay anything to the the bonus to them, because so the 21st was the guy sitting very close to me. I mean, in the office sitting very close to me. And it was out of, so maybe the closer maybe what Jordi says makes a lot of sense. But of course you have to be living in Bangor Park and relocate to that. So that was in Spain. So then when we came here, what happened to us, and which I hope I continue, and so we didn't talk to anybody. We waited, or somehow they started to call us. And why did it? But I am seeing this pattern happening over and over. I am seeing venture capitalists even calling to Spain quite often. I have a friend now, he's been called, he's a big data company, 7 venture capitalists from Europe and US, like wow. 4 of them US. So I'm seeing Bain Capital, the inside partners, all these guys, they even have inside sales. They have calling. Bain Capital, they call the company. And the way we engaged with Trident was this way. There was a guy calling, and they called us. So we had already a term sheet, and we went to see them, and we didn't expect anything, no? But when they saw the term sheet, they jumped in.
But when they call you, isn't it for companies already that have $1 or $2 million? Like revenue.
You know what?
We get calls too, and we talk to them. They call us finally, and then as soon as they know that we are still free revenue, we only have $500.
Most probably, but to get their attention, probably not. Probably if you are blogging and you're in a very, very vanguard big data thing or sexy stuff, no, and you are making yourself very sexy, I see people calling moreover, and also abroad. I don't think they were calling to Europe or Spain as they were calling them. So that, I mean, obviously it's much better to get them call you than you to call it. Obviously, you are in a much better position.
I find VCs are starting to specialize, to be very specific on what they want and what they don't want. And they know that what they want to do. And then, because they narrow down their spectrum so much, then they have to go out to look for.
Well, I think the prices are too high here, so they're going out. The world's
coming. tell me VCs besides Dave McClure and 500 Startups, that are, and some of them are in Berlin, I know.
Yeah.
Which ones are really going out and really not just shopping, but really making investments? Which American VC
Bain Capital is calling.
We got like
crazy European companies. I don't know how much they're investing, but they're writing term sheets. I know they're writing term sheets now in Spanish kind of guy.
Oh, wow.
So they're running
Bain Capital Ventures.
So how important is it to get a really good VC? You know, everyone hears you got to go to Sequoia, you got to, you know, whatever. You got to get the really good ones, because otherwise, what truth is there? What is there?
You know, I actually have this is like finding a teacher in a school.
Yep.
There are, you know, very fancy schools, and you can have a horrible teacher, or you can go to, you know, a not so good school and have a great teacher, right? So this is not about the firm so much, it's about who works in your company. So you literally have to do the work, you know, and almost like recruit. You're building your team, and the investor is part of your team.
So. But how do you do that? I mean, that all sounds so great, but how do you really do that?
I mean,
can you go to conferences? I think that's a great idea.
So no, you back channel.
But you don't have back channels. You're from Spain.
You don't have them yet. You speak with them. You know, I think that choosing an investor is a luxury that is great to have, but very seldom you have.
But that's okay?
Most people cannot choose. That.
Yeah. You have to fall.
Yeah. Yeah.
You have the first round, you get what you get. and you pray that the person's got, you know, a head on his shoulders.
And you're hoping that he or she has good connections.
And everything else.
That they work hard for you. To have connections, you have to actually make the calls and.
To me, the key thing is that they understand venture capital. They understand ventures. Okay, you have a lot of investment bankers. You have a lot of people who've never started a company. That, for whatever reason, they became lawyers. They raise a fund. Great, but they don't understand what you as an entrepreneur are suffering or are dealing with.
Yeah.
And that's the worst. That's your worst nightmare, is to have a board that doesn't understand what entrepreneurialism is about. So as long as you got somebody on your board who understands that and you can connect and work day to day, you're fine.
Yeah.
take the money. Now, second round, third round, yeah, then you can get it, you can be more choosy, because if you get to the second round, then you know you've proven a lot of things and it's going to be easier. And then you're looking for other things. But the company is also at a different stage. Yeah. So you're looking for another...
You know, I actually will disagree politely. No, there is more money in seed stage today than there's ever been. And it might not by a factor of like 10% or 20%, but I mean, valuations have gone on average, I think the median was 2 million in 2009 to like 7 last quarter. Yeah. It's a seed stage, right? Yeah, it's like people fighting for money, to give money to people. And I think a lot of, I mean, at least it's not so much. The Series B has gone up by 2, the Series A has gone up by 2.5, but we're going to almost 4x in, you know, 4 years, which is a huge number. So I think, you know, if you can't get money, I would say go back and rethink your product or rethink your market fit, because it's really, really important. Even when you're, it's almost like going, again, going back to school. Should you have a horrible teacher in kindergarten? I actually think the most important teachers are in kindergarten and first grade, because they're going to teach you how to think and how to go, and they have great connections. You can get a great Series A. So I think it matters. Actually, if you have money, you shouldn't take the money from people that you don't like.
Yeah, so you can choose by all means.
Yeah, let me add something. So for the people that, I don't know if you are all in the US or something, but many people is still in Spain, so it's very difficult to get a fund when you're not here. Yeah. So I think the Spanish venture capital can bridge that gap. In fact, for me, it happened with Adara. No? They bridged me, and they were not kind of Perkins, but they did their job perfectly, and they're starting to get contacts here. They can do that. So maybe that first step is in Spain, and we get a bond instrument, which is funding the second. You know.
And we almost invested in a company that was in Spain last year, but we wanted them to come here, because otherwise how are we going to help them? It's just giving money to somebody. We can't really help them.
And that is very good, but you would be an exception, investing in a company in Spain to come here.
No, but didn't.
We didn't, because they didn't come. They didn't want to come. You so, you know, if you don't want to come here, then who am I going to introduce you to? I can barely,
that's
you
right,
know.
That's right. Yeah, but I agree with you that your first money, probably, if you're starting a company, sending engineers here in Spain, you want to raise the first half of the million in Spain. If you can find somebody here who's going to fund you, that's great.
Absolutely. Yeah.
But most likely, it's going to be easier to get that funding in Spain.
Absolutely.
Is it because Brazil, I have Brazilian friends, and there was one, Cristiano, and he had a company, and he was, I do a lot in Brazil, and he wanted venture funding, and the VCs just wouldn't talk to him in Brazil. So he moved here. Within a week after he had a Palo Alto address, they started calling him. That all just that stupid move gave legitimacy to, oh, now he's here, now he's, you know, among the big boys.
But it's not legitimacy, it's like,
to them it was.
For me it's more like, okay, I want to give money and do something, not just, you know, write.
Absolutely. No, you want to see them and work with them. Absolutely. Which leads me to the question, when do you start looking for an investor? Do you first, you say, ask your family, your friends? What do you do then? Then you go to angels, and you go to, how do you know when the time is to look for investors? At what stage do you have to be? And how, I know, it's all relative. And how big does your team have to be? People ask me that. Is it enough for two? Do we have to be five? Well, that's the questions
I get. I don't think it's a question of the number of people. Right? I would say you need two things. I mean, it's a balance between, you need that to have, to stand up, I mean, to have some products, some business, some ideas, some great stuff, no? And then you need traction, you need both of them. So depending on how much you have, if you have the best idea in the world, you may get funded without the traction, but most probably you want to have half million.
Unless you're a serial entrepreneur, this is your third fund, your third startup.
Yeah.
Then maybe, right?
Yeah,
it's different if you're a first-time entrepreneur or not, and there's different stages, right? I think today you want to raise, the seeds have gone up. So if you want to raise a seed from an institutional seed fund, you have to have more than you used to have. You know,
you have to have a seed.
So if you want to raise.
Okay, what does that mean? For those that don't know what that means, what does that mean to have a series series A?
You already have revenue. You're not pre-revenue.
There we go.
You have revenues, you have clients that are recurring, maybe not a lot, but some that keep coming back. And you can prove that this is not just a one-off client, but it's an ongoing basis.
But you know, I think
that used to be series B before.
Now it's a seed stage, isn't it? A lot of them. Yeah.
I mean, I think if you just say two people, no product, I mean, barely a prototype, right? Maybe somebody in the audience is this way. And there's no customer yet, or maybe there's only a few users. You haven't even launched it. You can do a lot with very little money, especially if there's a developer in the team. And, you know, it's incredible because we all know it used to take $5 million here to start a company, and now maybe $50,000. And, you know, actually somebody, I did this, you know, statistic about like, how much does it really take to get 1 million users if you're a consumer? How much money? So, you know, it took Facebook, you know, when Facebook got 1 million users, there were actually only 11 people working at Facebook. So you can do a lot with very little, right? And it took them 10 months. Instagram, it was like, I think it's like 4 people in 2.5 months.
Right.
Yeah. It was a Brazilian and two Brazilian.
Last year, it was Yo. It was one person, 1 month, you know? So
Yo still exists.
It still exists. It's up and running. So my point is, like, I think if you have the, it's almost like how iterating on the product, you can do it fairly efficiently without spending a lot of money, and you don't need to go raise a seed round of $1 million or $2 million. You can do a lot with under 500. And once you think that it's clicking, like sales, you're not gonna have to hire a sales team to do enterprise sales, you know, before you raise a bunch of money, because salespeople are really expensive. But you know, you can become your own salesperson. So, anyways, I think you can do a lot with not so much, which is great.
I agree 100%. I think attraction is the key, but I always recommend people start talking to investors as soon as you can. Don't get obsessed about it. Don't just make it 90% of your time, but do spend time going to events, go to pitch events, see how others pitch.
Absolutely.
Introduce yourself to investors, tell them what you're working on, tell them that you're not ready and to talk to him, but you would like his business card so you can call him and then say something for her. And say something wacky so they remember you when you call. And that's the relationship.
That's good.
And
I think a lot of people don't understand that Silicon Valley, as anywhere in the world, is all about relationships. And it's not just whom you know, but it's who knows you.
And find people who know people. That's obviously most VCs will pay so much more attention to you if you come with a referral of somebody else. And if you're not out there in the network of entrepreneurs, in all the events and some parties and so forth, then you're an outsider. Then you don't exist.
I think most people are. Does anyone have a question now, before? No questions. Yes.
Can you comment on the other stages of fundraising other than VCs or angel, like early stage like SBIR grants or other type of?
I'm sorry, what was the
SBIR grant?
I have no clue what that is.
Something in that.
We actually have a few companies that have gotten those SBIR grants.
What is that?
The government gives grants to small businesses.
The US government?
Yes. And they split them into two chunks.
Oh, wow.
And I think the first one is not so big, and the second one is bigger. And I thought you actually have to be a scientist to get this grant, but it turns out that this guy that is doing like Facebook ads for small businesses got the grant. So I think it's great. I think actually non-dilutive money is the best money to raise. Yeah. So I'm all for it.
Yeah.
You know, they have a special version for small businesses where they do like really fast. They give you really fast. They like
that's fast.
I don't know about the ones in the States, but Spain has a lot of you from Spain. The ENISA, there are tons of them. They're very good. 10-year loan, very low interest rates, so 1% or something like that a year. And you know, you don't need any guarantee. So if the company flops, then you just write it off. And they're very good and they're very efficient in giving loans. So there are several at the national level and at the autonomous community at the EU level. There are quite a few of them.
Do any of you have any experience with end customers funding the development of a product that they themselves are going to use in the future? I've heard even of companies sort of getting paid to allow you to develop the product for them, so that the first customers get free, basically.
I've heard of Russian
companies. There is a lot of that. I mean, today, some of their first income is paid by Disney and Nickelodeon, and they had certain requirements that were very high for performance of games. They did it for them, now they're marketing to the rest of the community. So, so to speak, there is always a paying client, but that's even with Oracle, the software houses, they always have a client that pays for it. They get into aviation because there's an aviation company that needs something, they're going to pay for it. And part of the agreement is that they'll be able to market it to other people, so the cost is lower for the payer.
And that would be not diluted money.
That would be client's revenue, that would be non-diluted money. But then you can make all kind of deals. Some of them, sometimes they ask for a little bit of your equity. And
that's what we call intercapital, is maybe the larger one here.
Say it louder.
Intercapital is maybe the largest. And what they look for is not just the financial return, but you're doing something in the area that they are interested on. That means if you can convince them that you have both, then you have a greater chance than if you just go to a VC.
I mean, I think that
strategic value.
You're talking about corporate venturing, right? Mm-hmm. That's corporate venturing. So that's corporations funding projects that fit their needs. That's like BBVA Ventures operating out here in Silicon Valley, Intel Capital, Google Ventures, although they claim they're fairly independent. Most of the companies have, even Facebook has some kind of venture arm. Most of them have that, and those, that's as good money as anything else. But remember that is
good.
That gives you a lot of credibility and can help in the next round.
Yeah, I was going to say we have companies that, pre-sell before the product is done. And I think it's great because you get cash early or, you might get whatever. But the challenge is when you are building a product for somebody, they're like, you're only just doing it for them. And they might have requirements that are very specific to them. So then it's almost like services business and like drugs, you keep doing it and then it's very hard to strip it and be the product that you can sell to a lot of people. So you have to be very diligent. And I always tell our companies, get more than one customer. If you're building a product, at least get two specs. So that forces you to build something that you can sell eventually.
Or Kickstarter.
No, Kickstarter is the definition of that.
Exactly, if you think about it.
Kickstarter is that.
And would you consider Kickstarter as a viable source?
I know people that they're doing it, not in the IT world. I see people more like they're building clothes or not, whatever. But it works.
It's small amounts.
Yeah. I don't know for IT. But it's amazing because they get the customers pay you before you build the thing.
Well, smart things did it, and they're pretty big now. Where you can control the home, Exactly, and they did it for Kickstarter. Why do I know? Because I bought it. I'm a sucker for Kickstarter. I buy so much stuff.
It's great. It's a great marketing validation. Mm-hmm. Crowdsourcing and it's successful, then your original question, the more the VCs will call you.
Exactly. Anyone else have a question?
Sort of to go even further. We were with a session today with Accenture, and they're saying, we're finding startups that would be disruptive to our existing clients. Mm. And what we do is we're like finding those things that could be dangerous to them. But that means you get in front of what would be your competitor. That's kind of pushing it to the limit, wouldn't it? That would be...
So what? In front of your competitor, you're disruptive, other people are disruptive, that's the name of the game.
But the question is, if you invest in company A and you meet company B that's going to be a competitor for your company A, could you then also invest in that company B? You really shouldn't, should you?
Well, VCs wouldn't, probably.
No, they wouldn't.
VCs would very not. Focus not on one it. Company per, right. per segment.
Yeah. But the thing would be, this would have to be done with a mediator like Accenture that would give you the validation, but you would go to the competitor and say, we have this that's going to disrupt your market. We're validated by an Accenture or somebody who can give us some kind of validity, but then get the company that you're disrupting to fund you.
Sounds complicated.
There are people who are investing on defensive. There is a lot of that happened in the alternative energy industry. There was a time that Middle East was buying any new alternative energy that was coming out, and they were shelving it. But I don't see that happening now. You go go to your competitor and say, I might disrupt your industry, they'll say, well, let's talk and see if we can do something together. Otherwise, they'll say, bring it up, you know. Find you in the marketplace. Yeah.
Exactly. We'll say, well, wait, I'm going to relax.
What's the...
Sorry, I think what you meant just from us talking briefly is not so much your competitor, right? It could be a potential strategic customer, a very large customer of yours,
no.
that you could enable the business, but you need validation, right?
So no.
And Accenture gives you the validation.
No, I'm thinking of,
I think it's much
if
worse.
I'm going to design engineering software, I would go to AutoCAD.
Okay.
And AutoCAD would say, what you're doing is something that we have in our research labs, but we don't want to do it, or thanks for the ideas. Thank you. You know, it's very risky because you show your cards.
Well, typically big companies are, I mean, anyways, I think ideas are cheap and execution is absolutely hard.
Okay.
So, I mean, if you go to a big company and be like, dude, I have this great idea, these guys have to get it through so many hoops and so many things to something happen.
Well, not invented here.
If the company has no cash, if that company that you want to sell into has no cash or the financial sheets are terrible, then maybe, right? But if like somebody like Google, let's assume, somebody huge, right? Be like, well, we'll just wait and buy it because it's nothing.
Yeah.
So it's not.
Well, they'll encourage you to go
yeah.
build it and
yeah,
wait and
buy
it.
They're not going to steal it.
And
no.
then they might partner with you at some point, or you may want to partner
yeah.
with them, and then when you work with them for
That's
a while and partner, then they'll might give you an offer that you want to reject.
I think a lot of people that come here, maybe not Spaniards, but other nationalities, they're afraid that their ideas will be stolen.
Oh.
I think that's one of the initial ideas. Forget the NDA. Everyone knows you shouldn't ask for an NDA, but they're still very, very hesitant to
yeah.
talk about their ideas. But as you said, execution is everything, right?
It's a matter.
Yeah.
Same idea to different people, different companies.
The same ideas are all over the place.
All over the place.
I was judging the stuff
right.
at Chile
right.
event this afternoon,
yeah.
and I saw three ideas that I've just seen here.
Yeah.
Recently, and one of them it was a Hungarian guy that came and. Was having a coffee with him. Today is his Hawaiian children working. That's good.
But then what? So I was working with Russians today, and they had some ideas, which I had already heard at 500 startups, the last batch. But I mean, aren't they then behind in a way when you say you got to catch up? Or?
It's all about execution.
It's all about your product. How good is your product? Look at Google. They were like, you know, when I was at school, it was.
I know. Yeah.
I mean, it was clear once you used it, you're like, I'm never going to use anything else. So, you know, have the best product possible. That's what counts.
So the other question is, how much investment, please?
What do you assess in an entrepreneur and a startup when you are going to invest in them?
Great question.
In the stage, when you don't have any revenues or you can have them, but not yet.
You know, it's the most important thing because you're right, there's nothing. So you really have to, you know, people come here, they might have an idea, sometimes they have a prototype, but most of the time it's nothing. So how do you do it? And, you know, we look a lot at the team, you know, how they talk to each other, they compliment, they respect each other. Sometimes people come here, they fight in front of us, and you're like, okay, here you go. Because it's all about the people. But then, you know, it's also the way the entrepreneur talks and how they, you know, you could say, you know, even the guy doing Uber could have explained Uber saying, well, I'm going to do some car sharing, something. And the guy, when he talks, it's like, I'm going to change world transportation, right? So they have a mission, they have a vision, and they're going somewhere. You know, it's not like they're building a product, it's kind of their life is in it. So, you know, it's very subtle, and I think we make mistakes all the time, but that's kind of what we look for.
You know, one of the things I've heard, I've interviewed about 7 people for my YouTube channel, all VCs or investors, and one of them was Pitch Johnson. He's been around since 1968. And he was saying that he decides in the first 20, and for me as a European, it's weird, first 20, 30 seconds, does he like them? Are you likable?
Mm-hmm.
And that is a huge factor that weighs in on the decision. Do you do that too, in a sense, even if you don't do it consciously?
I think that's what I actually do. I always remember this.
And he must have been very likable to get all this stuff.
He is very likable.
No, but I always remember the movie, Steve Jobs movie. So
mm-hmm.
I think the first guy that invested in him, he says, I'm going to invest you, I mean, you're doing something that other people are doing. personal computer is not something you invented, but it, it was, apparently it was, because I see this look in your eyes.
Yeah.
And I agree to all of you. So you see some people, they have fever, they are hungry, they have hunger, they are like burning, and they're gonna go jump crazy about it. So that's so for me, that's it's about a lot about that. It's about this intuition that this guy is absolutely gonna die, and he has something.
Yeah,
he has
yeah.
So I mean, I do some angel investment myself, and I, that's how I got myself with that.
I'll give you two data points of two companies that I presented recently. One was Foundation Capital. And the guy told us we have three criteria. First criteria is how big is the market. Second criteria is the technology. Third criteria is the team. He says, if you don't pass the first criteria that the market is big enough, we then go into the second criteria to look at your technology. They don't listen to your technology until they understand how big is your market. Because they say, if your technology is great, but so-so, we can fix it with money, we can improve it, we can buy something, we can fix it. If the team is not totally something not working, we can change people, we can bring new people. But we cannot make the market big. So you've got to have a very big market. And I find that here, they're obsessed about $1 billion market, at least.
See, the market is important, but the only thing you cannot fix is the founding team not working together.
Okay,
it's impossible.
So unless you fire someone. You fire someone.
For us, it's, number one is a team.
So these are the criteria. The second one is, the second one was technology. Obviously, you have to address a need and so on and so forth. And what is the team and all of that.
And then the team. So for me, it's important adding two, because you can have a great team that are very happy together, but ultimately, they just...
You know, when the job is trouble, right?
A good team, they don't necessarily get along to get stuff done.
But in what was key, and for me it's very important now in the new venture, for me it's obsessive, it's the global market. What is the global market? The way you're going to... So that for me the technology is, as I grow older, I was a programmer and I was crazy about technology, but the value is, at least in software, no? You feel the value of it. Anyone can do. Any product can be built with the right amount of money and with a good, and so the technology I give it secondary importance. I mean, now, so the government, how can this technology really become create a global global lead generation machine? In the case of Limbo, how can you get freedom models? How can you this the global opportunity? So that's what happened in Limbo. In Limbo, we created an open source model, which made us global awareness. Not we were not selling at the beginning; we were just giving it away. But that happened to be a lead generation, global lead generation. So that was absolutely the difference that between Limbo and the rest of CM vendors that grew 200-300 of them, they're dead out of the that's the real story. The only European non-US CM vendor is here before. So, and the difference, we were smaller, we were, but we had that vision. How can we globalize? How can do we could we have the opportunity, defensive, and the ability to attract customers from and disrupt the cost of sales. So the cost of sales is key. It's not only about
how the
technology, but how, because ultimately the one who sells better is the who wins, not the one who has the better technology.
But that's not only software, that's also hardware. So I'm totally enamored of robotics. I did Singularity's executive program, and I think robotics is incredible how it's going to change it. Still even when I'm alive. So the question is, what if you don't have software, but you have hardware, or you have, you know...
It's all about how do you get customers. I agree 100% with you.
Think about Apple and Microsoft, think about the VHS and the beta videos.
Oh, yeah.
It's not about the best technology, it's who is going to sell it. Oracle and the other databases. So there are examples of not best technology at the beginning, but the best selling capacity.
So even in robotics, AI, those kinds of things.
Yeah, hardware, videos, I guess it's a question of how good you're selling, your displays, and your models, no? And your, for example, I have a guy that says, no, because of one Apple, because they gave it, they enhanced piracy. So the model was, anyway, so you have to find disruptive ways of getting known, getting...
Wait. Apple enhanced piracy?
That's my friend's idea. No, I'm just giving an example.
Apple charged $1.99 for songs, so just to discourage us from hiring.
That somehow something changed, disrupted, and the disrupted ways of getting to the customer, cheaper and faster.
I think I totally agree, and I don't know how many people here is technical versus business, but
how many people here are technical versus business? Raise your hand, technicals.
Technical people. It's good. But I, you know, I think, and I was an engineer, I think, you know, when I got to school, I'm like, why do I need a salesperson? You know, it's going to be really easy. This is the best thing. But it's really important. It's almost, if you're building a consumer product, it's so important to have a somebody who understands digital marketing and growth in your team, in your initial team, okay, co-founding team, because if you have e-commerce, the hardest part of e-commerce is not to have the product, it's to get people to come to your website. People just think, just open the website, they'll show up. They don't show up. You have to know.
Which is another question, sorry. How do you find a co-founder? I have people who come here, have the greatest idea, and they're either technical or they're business, and they're desperately looking for that co-founder. Is that findable? Can you really find a co-founder here? Or are they kind of also already like in a dance bacon?
I know people who have found a co-founder.
I think it's very difficult. I think that co-founders find themselves, they gravitate to each other. I didn't know people looked for co-founders. I mean, we connect, we are friends.
No, people look for like does anyone have any chemistry in that?
I know people do that here in hackathons. But I think that you've said some interesting things that are very important to emphasize, because you use the word scalable, because you didn't say it very, very emphatically. But I think this is a very important thing that VCs are looking for. They're looking for businesses that can be scalable and that can grow global relatively easily. The go-to-market is very important. I'll take it one level further. We were presenting to Andreessen Horowitz recently, and we were explaining the model, and at some point he made a comment and said, well, I don't know if Apple will like that. Hmm. We're like, what does Apple have to like that? Who cares, you know? And then he said, then he said something about selling the company. During the whole presentation, he was thinking, who was he going to sell the company?
Wow.
We were presenting the business and talking about what we were doing and who we were and the team and all of that, and he was just screening it for who could he sell the company if we achieve everything we were telling. The guy was thinking about the exit from the moment we walked into the room. And we were like, wow, that is something else that I had never experienced. But, you know, they are in the business of investing to sell the business, and so they can get the return. And they want to do it, you know, in a 5 to 10 year time frame. And these time frames are narrowing down. Sometimes if they can sell it in 2 or 3 years rather than in 5 or 10. I don't know what's your time frame for us being an investment.
We're already behind. Yeah, but companies are staying private longer. I don't know, it's changed so much in the last 5 years. I think again, if you don't raise a lot of money, it's really easy to sell you because people have cash, built enough value. So you can do these quick sales, 2 or 3 years, or whatever, or even a year. Right? I mean, it won't be like 100 million or 200 million. Sometimes they are, like smart things. It wasn't that old, for example. And it was a hardware company. Mm-hmm. So, but the huge successes, like, you know, Dropbox, Snapchat, Uber, all those guys, and it's taken them 5 more years to go public. And some of them may not even go public. Whatever.
So which leads me to the question, how much money do you ask for? You have to go, you know, okay, you have your friends, you maybe have 200,000 or 100, you're lucky, you do whatever. Hopefully not just building another app.
Okay.
I don't know about you, but
I have a very strong feeling on this one.
Oh, good. Well, let me hear this. I love strong feelings. Tell me the strong feeling.
You know, at least at the seed stage, I think when you're in Series B or
No, we're not talking about seed, you have a plan, and so on.
Yeah. But here, most people come and say, well, I need $1 million because there's 5 people and I want it to last 18 months. And you're like, okay, what are you going to do?
Exactly.
And I think the most important thing is raise as much money as it takes you to get to the next step where your valuation will be higher.
But not more.
No, I mean,
that's my answer.
I would say always
take it from my mouth.
2x.
you know, put a cushion because it always takes you twice as long as you think.
But how do you know realistically? You kind of have an idea, just start.
You have to make a plan.
But how do you do that? How do you make a realistic
plan? Absolutely, it's very simple. You make a plan, and you don't have to come and write a 60-page document on what you're going to get done in 12 months. It's like, okay, I have to build an app, I need to hire one person, maybe I have to hire an engineer, a designer, so roughly you have a
and
sense.
I need 50,000 users, and 50,000 users are going to cost me so much in advertising, it's going to cost me so much time, so I need the person to support that, and it's going to be 18 months, and 18 months I need to have another small business.
So to Milena's question, if people tell me I need this money because I want it to last 18 months, it's already like a big negative, like they don't know what they're doing, so.
Yeah, you want to move to the next level. There's nothing worse than raising funds and moving to the next level, and you don't get to the next level.
But what if you didn't? What if you didn't ask for enough? People will say, you know, we're so afraid we're going to run out, and then I'm afraid to go and ask for more money.
No, you cannot. You don't have to be afraid. You just call it.
Happens
right?
All the time.
Happens all the time. You do a seed, you don't have enough money. You do a seed plus.
But you should ask for money when you don't need it.
Absolutely.
That's the first rule. When you need the money,
what does that mean when you don't need it?
When you need the money, you are under pressure.
You're
desperate, and you can accept anything you can. And
yeah.
People and the venture capitalists, which are nice guys, but anyway,
they will
negotiate as strongly, no? or they even maybe not like you so much. No?
Absolutely.
But whenever you are, first thing I tell venture capitalists, I'm not interested in run.
I think you have to know a little bit the numbers that the market has. There's some kind of unspoken numbers there. You know, if you are an idea with some market motivation but not a whole lot, but the product is ready or almost ready, you can command a valuation of $3.5 million. Then you can raise $500 million. That's the space of angels and angel groups.
Yeah.
Some VCs might play there, but not that many. If you already have some recurring results and clients that keep coming back, then you can bring your valuation at $7 million pre-money. Then you can ask for $1 or $2 million. Anybody who puts money will always want at least 15 to 33% of the company.
Yeah.
That's the number. So, you know, if you have a valuation of $7 million, you raise two, the investor might be okay. Now you have $5 million in revenues or $2 million in revenues, then you can raise $5 million at a valuation of 2025. And if you're in a very bad segment, then your valuation can be anything. If the pie is much bigger.
You're a good company, it won't happen.
Yeah,
the important
thing is you have a good company.
The important thing is when you raise money that the absolute price doubles. Or
exactly.
So then you calculate the dollars and then you're happy, no problem. But the problem is if you raise money and the value is that doesn't go up, then you...
But chances are that as an entrepreneur, you may end up with 23% of the company by the time it's...
So you have to be realistic about that from the beginning.
How much is it, 20?
20-30% of the company.
With
after a number of rounds,
and
when you finish with
it's
very
difficult.
Very
not even 20.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
Not even 20.
I think typically founders and other players, when they're talking about
Does that surprise you that number?
Because there is, but you have to make sure the pie gets bigger.
Yeah.
So
I mean, it really depends, right?
So 5 to 10% of a billion, like what's it, like what's up, or like
but it really depends.
That's
on Instagram.
50 million. Yeah.
I mean, the amazing companies that have grown really fast, like Facebook. Dropbox,
but
they have like insane amounts of equity.
Those are exceptions.
I think a lot of people think that. Come on, I worked my you know what off. I want more than 20%.
So the thing is that you believe in what you see. So in Spain, you don't see a guy that sold a company for $1 billion. Here, you see them all the time. No, that's true. You see them. So people, you grow. I guess if you grow here and you see them and you hear about your cousin or somebody, your friend. You start to believe it. So you think you're going to be able to grow up to $1 billion. So 5% is fine. 10% of 1 billion is fine. I think it's fine. No problem. But if you think it's going to go to 10 million, then 10% is not good.
The toughest part is at the beginning, because if you don't really grow as much and your valuation doesn't grow as much, or you have a bad luck that you have to raise funds in 2007, 2008, 2009.
Yeah.
Although he did it, here's the exception, but 2001, 2002, the market was dry, it was impossible to raise a penny. Then you have to do flat round or down rounds, and that is what is very dilutive. However, I have a project that the CEO has diluted below 20%, 17%, and I'm helping him negotiate with the new round investors that they give him a 5% bonus, equity bonus, based on milestones. And we're kind of begging, and, you know. So it's good for him, and we position it also that in round B, it's not going to be good if he has less than 20%.
Yeah, what happens here, it's very common, is in every next round, this, especially the CEO, the executives, they get a good re-up. I mean, they get good startups.
What does a re-up stand for?
Re-up, so they kind of give them a good chunk of startups every time there's a fundraise.
But as it depends on the size and the...
Between what and what?
No, 5% is a lot. Well, depends on the size, for example, for the...
Don't want to get diluted.
But they try you not to dilute when you are the CEO and that really happens. So that helps. That helps quite a lot. Happening every single round. It's calculating into the round. So the round calculate what is the pre-money, what is the post-money, and what is the new, the re-up, the stock-ups and re-up, which is costly. It's costly. It's, maybe it's 5%, but for everybody.
For everyone, yeah. Not the employees.
Not for the CEO. If 20% every time.
Right.
So when you find this, going back a step, when you find this great VC, this wonderful firm, should you interview them? Should you, even if you're, you know, this little two-member, whatever, but you have good, I mean, can you say, are we a good fit for you? You know, what do you do if you see a competitor? What other questions did I write down? Hold on.
I think you definitely should. I mean, you're a VC, is somebody you're over marrying, you know. You're going to spend more time with your VC than
with your wife. Your partner, startup, you know? Yeah.
So you want to make sure that you click and that, you know, that you can have an argument with them, because when things are going well, everything is going to be fine. They love you, you love them. But when things go bad, and in a business, you always will have.
Yeah, but here you are, the two co-founders, maybe have a third or fourth teammate, and have this great opportunity. Finally met the VC, finally maybe wants to invest in you. Can you say, you know, do you have any referrals from other startups? Yeah. And how does that do? That isn't insulting. Is that something you recommend?
Well, I wouldn't ask for the referrals before they make you an offer, but once they make you an offer, absolutely.
You get the term sheet first.
Yeah.
I mean, that's good.
When I want to see your referrals. You're like, okay.
When they do the due diligence, you do your due diligence.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah. But you should ask. I mean, it's good. How are you going to help me?
Right?
You know, what do you know about my area?
No, they will.
But you should know that ahead of time.
Mm. Or not.
Really?
That's what you don't need to do.
A good VC will sell himself or herself to you.
But unless you're doing clean tech, you shouldn't go to someone who does hardware.
Well, obviously, but even within IT, a good VC will tell you very quickly why you want to work with him. And very quickly during the meeting, he'll say things to prove himself that he can add a lot of value to you, that it's not just check.
And how much do you believe it when people really tell you that stuff? Do they always mean it? Because I've heard where they say a lot and then you go and it's like, eh.
If it's not true, you will find out. That's not good.
Yeah, I mean, but when can you count on it?
That's why you have to do some back calls, right? Once you get an offer, you really
got
to do it.
You ask their portfolio, call the CEO and say, look, I have a term sheet, I wanted to hear from you. Are they active in the board? Did they help you? Did they open doors for you?
Right.
I mean, things that are not so...
But you should ask the companies that are no longer in the portfolio. Those are going to tell you. No. You ask the portfolio companies, it's like, tell me if you like your boss. Well, yes, it's great. Yeah, it's very hard.
So you had a question.
Yes, well, I have a question that is, so for example, Jordi say that, well, a clever VC should sell you But the problem is, okay, we are in Silicon Valley and they are specialists to sell to you what you are doing to say.
Exactly.
So, when I talk to an investor, it's something like, wow, this guy, you know, this person is unbelievable, he is very clever, he is awesome, he is magic. I mean,
yeah.
The problem is, if I get married, maybe I get married with the wrong person, you know?
I mean, but you can't get a divorce here. But
and the problem is, how you know that? Because, of course, so by one side, they're saying to me, no, the valuation is not important. But on the other side, if everybody seems to me marvelous, I mean, I have to go to the valuation.
Yeah.
But this is wrong. No, so I mean, which is the, you know, which is the balance? Because for me, I mean, so I don't have I don't know how to make a global business and to make a very beautiful, super power billion company.
But nobody is 100% perfect.
But everybody
you're looking for a partner that will fill the holes that you have. Okay? So, you know, and most of the holes that many entrepreneurs have, I find, are in marketing and sales. Okay? They're engineers, they can develop great products, they can even figure out the legal work, finances, and so on and so forth. But setting up a sales organization, very difficult. Probably, I think, is the most difficult job in any corporation is to manage salespeople. Hiring them is easy. With money, you can hire them. But managing them and keeping them producing and keeping them motivated and keeping them, this is very difficult. And managing Americans are very difficult. Managing American salespeople is very difficult because they're great at selling themselves. And then when it's time to work, you know, if you're not there, they may slack. And so managing sales is. So I look for VCs that really can help me in the business development, also can open doors if I have some strategic accounts. But you know, opening doors doesn't matter because opening doors, you can hire lead generation people, you can do all kinds of things. But to me is people who understand the business, who can work with me and who can help in the business development side.
But then, I have another question. So, if people don't understand the business, but the problem is, as I'm a startup, I even don't understand my business myself. I mean, because I'm generating the business. So, how is possible that a person outside me understand better than the business than me, than myself?
Usually, I find that they know the market very well.
Well, I think the entrepreneurs who are working there all the time typically have a much better idea than I do when I come once a week. I just don't know as much as they do because they're there all the time and they have a sense. But you know, we're a little bit come out and you really want to have a close relationship with the investor, somebody that you, when you have a problem, you're okay saying it, right? Because then they can help you. Sometimes entrepreneurs just want to say everything is going great and then, you know, it takes a long time to find out that there is a problem somewhere. But if you, you know, if you have to choose between two people, that they're both great, they know the market, they can help you with sales, everything. And the second thing for me would be like, am I going to be able to go out to dinner with this guy and tell him my problems? Because that's, you know, sometimes people are very strong and you don't want to tell them, but that's when people can help you. That's what I think. There's always problems, ups and downs.
And there's also very specialized VCs here.
Yeah.
So there's guys that they really know about the business. For example, these guys that they're super specialized in security, they've done four or five IPOs in security, and they are at least in the sales, in the marketing,
oh, yeah.
And they can really, really give you lots of things. No?
I think the other thing, since I've spoken to you, I know a little bit your technology, you're going to talk to a lot of people, right, typically before you get money, and each one of those guys is going to be very smart and have slight perspective, right, and you're going to be picking it up and triangulating and comparing. And I think the point somebody sort of checking there, eventually when they get serious, you ask them for references, they're going to respect you for that. I think Mara's point is very good, which is some of the companies that are no longer portfolio companies,
yeah.
And they're going to only respect you for that. So eventually you're going to have had so many conversations that you're going to feel much more comfortable.
Finally, you need
right?
chemistry with
them. That's what I'm saying, you need to be able to talk to them.
You need to feel good with them because it's a marriage, no? So it's going to be having this guy, no, in this difficult. So that's very, very important.
Jordi, you mentioned about the sales team or whatever is very important. Which is a way, expectation they have when you come with a company here to take over the American market, the North American market? first than any other place. Of course, you have to put that it's easy to globalize, it's perfect, but this is the expectation with them. Is the American market the first expectation for?
Yeah. They're betting on your ability to make money and the company create a lot of value in the U.S. market.
In the U.S. market.
Everything you do outside is very important. And eventually, you know, for B's and C rounds, globality is very important. But I think that for a C to a Series A round, it's just the U.S. market. Just prove that you can compete in this very, very competitive market, in this very fast, very dynamic market. You prove that. That's what.
And you also have the I think I heard that 51% of the IT spending is in the U.S. So somehow it's also traded worldwide. Wow. So you have market here. So why would you go to small economy? No. And then you have this one single language and this one single culture that they buy in the phone. It's very transactional. It's not that independent, not that. So why would you go out until you really can ramp until 20 million? So that's what I see.
Yeah, I think there's only one exception, which is if you're in e-commerce, I would encourage anybody to go to Asia or open some Mandarin site, because the numbers are not bigger by 10x, they're actually bigger by 1,000x. So, you know, it's much easier to get a customer to your site if you're can figure out China. I'm not saying you do it, but that's the only thing I would consider. It's just radically larger. Somebody told me today that November 11th is this kind of Valentine's Day in China, and Alibaba sold...
Singles Day.
Something like that. Anyways, they sold $1 billion in 20 minutes. So, you know, that's the size of their e-commerce there. It's incredible.
But I'll tell you a story about the sales team. We are now working on a closing of a deal in LA, and the VC is obsessed on who's going to be our sales manager. And he wants to be the sales manager. It's like, you're still negotiating salary. You cannot meet him. He's going to ask for more money. And they're obsessed about who's going to... They know that we can evangelize. They know that we need to have a local team to sell. Because we go with our accent and everything else. They know that they want a local team. And we have a guy. We have a candidate. We have a analyzing with him. But they're absolutely obsessed. And when they heard, they understood that we had said it, but they hadn't heard it. That we hadn't hired him, he's been working for us yet, but we already have shaken hands. They were kind of a little bit upset, he got very nervous suddenly. And now they understand that he's going to be an expensive salesperson, it's going to cost us $300,000 a year, and we cannot afford it until we have our round close.
What are you also saying about the question, as a foreigner or as a Spaniard for your case, what are the problems that you encounter? And is there still, I mean, I think the tendency has changed in the last years of replacing the CEO just because he was either foreign or whatever, for whatever reasons. You had some comments about that.
Yeah, so the parameters on the US business need, and then in my case, it was a problem. In fact, we had a crisis there because then they wanted a US corporation, so they say, I think they like to think they invest globally, but it's not true. And at some point, they will accept it. No, it's not true, Julio. We only invest. We want that our corporations, we don't want to be messing around with complicated stuff. So then, so the thing is, you are your IP, your intellectual properties in Spain. Well, it depends on each case. But many times for Spanish entrepreneurs, the IP is built in Spain in a Spanish company. So if you take this IP to the US, you're going to have to pay taxes, huge amount of taxes, huge amount of taxes.
Yeah.
So basically you can't do it. So you have to do something called re-domestication, which is removing the actual same company into Delaware. Changing the address, but the company is the same. So you can do that. But
it's a change of address. But it's a very complex interface.
But then you need
it's easy to
emails.
Do.
Yeah, but it's
doable.
Easy. I'd say
doable,
it's
not easy.
It's a six-month process to do it.
But this process you have to, for the Spanish section, for the Spanish, the journey in Delaware is maybe one day, this is for Spain. It's maybe it could be months, it could be 6 months, it could be 7 months. So then you have a investor wanting to invest in your company, whenever it's U.S. but you have the company in Spain, and then it's 6 months to relocate. So that's a pretty stressed situation because you don't want to have 6 months in between. And you know, the money comes, and you're going to be asking every quarter, okay, so how did the sales come? And any small thing could change the mind. So you should be thinking about that. And you should be thinking about the IP. The IP contracts, they're crazy about having very tight IP contracts and very complex contracts with them. Anybody who wrote a line of code has to be tied with a 14 pages contract, even if he left the company 5 years ago, it doesn't matter. So it's hard to manage that. And then, these kind of things. What else
in your opinion, is the change of CEO a requirement?
So for me, I had a couple of term sheets and some others that all of them wanted to replace me. So I think I'm not a CEO, I am like managing, so I'm more an engineer, so I wanted to leave, but I was telling them, I promise you, I want to leave, I want a CEO, but they wouldn't believe it, no, because here the mindset is, I mean, you have to be a CEO, that's the best thing you can be in your life. No? So then, they do believe it. So anyway, we're going to write it here in the conditions. So I think, you know, it was right, in my case, was right. I think many cases going to be this way, because, you know, selling the U.S. in U.S. language, in the U.S. culture, with
it's
the
different
U.S.
way of really, thinking.
You know what? It's totally different thing, and it's really difficult. It's a really big challenge. So you probably want a senior sales guy who has been here 20 years and it happens. And the cultural thing is, so you need this CEO to be your managing that situation, you know, because you are part of the operational team. You are not, you could be on the board also. So that is challenging. That in our case was very critical. And
when did you bow out? How long had you been involved deeply in the company, and then you said, I'm going to the next stage? Did you then go to the board, or you left? What did you do?
No, I talked to
that was it your A round or your B round?
No, that was in the B round. That was in the B round.
That's a bit my view also. That I think in the A round they want to see continuity. I don't think that CEO today is so much of an issue. But I think that when the $20 million come in, then the game changes.
In the last day. Well, in A-Run, we had agreed that we would have a CEO. We would have the veto. I mean, we had the right to decide. It wasn't that they could put anybody, no? And it was an incredible hiring process done by the VC, but incredible, I think. It was worth whatever money you wanted to know. And then we found it right here, in fact, and that was key for the next stages. So I think the money that came into a new stage, totally new stage, thanks to that.
For one of my projects, the CEO hasn't come out, but just because we've been careful, we're saying we do want to hire a country manager. Because the company is also operating in Spain, and we also have a deal that we're going to develop in China, and Middle East, and so on and so forth. And we don't want to hire a CEO who's managing the global thing. We can manage the global thing. Mm-hmm. But yeah, to manage the global market, the local sales teams, and so on and so forth, for that we want to hire a local country manager. And that's what they are demanding, what they're kind of obsessed about.
Yeah, I've run out of questions. Do you have any more questions?
Can you comment on the incubators or accelerators that are in the area? Those apply to any type of startups, and what's the situation in Europe or especially in Spain for them?
Well, I think there are a lot of accelerators and incubators here, and they are all evolving very much, and I think they're all getting better and better. Mm-hmm. I think originally you would refer to an incubator, a place that might look something like this, where you could just
rent. Co-working
space where you could rent space and they would organize events. They may have accountants and lawyers around that you can use, and recruiters and pitch coaches and one day a week CFOs and all kinds of things. And that's fine, that works. I think it's better to be in this environment than to be in your apartment by yourself. That stays value added there. I think a lot of those incubators have wanted to add more value, and they're creating a lot of acceleration programs, mostly mirroring probably the most well-known or successful one, the Y Combinator one. 500 Startups is another one. What the Spain Tech Center is now doing is very simple. It's a shorter 2-week version of that. I think those are very good, and they're very good because it's very intensive acceleration, and that's great. If in 3 months or 2 months, you can learn as much as you would learn in 2 years or 3 years because they're exposing you to a lot, that's fantastic. The better part or a great part of those accelerators like Y Combinator, and many of them, is even Spain Tech Center, is they, at the end of the session, they organize for VCs to come and hear you pitch. So there you have a great way to meet VCs because they come to you that afternoon or evening, they're dedicating it to that team of entrepreneurs. So go grab them as much as you can. You'll have to elbow a few people.
But you can meet them before, so I'm the mentor of 500, and there's so many investors there. Yeah. That's one of the benefits of accelerators.
And I think VCs like those environments well because, you know, it's a very efficient for them, a very efficient way for them to see deal flow. Deal flow that has been trained well, that has been pre-screened, and I have to say
it's changed a lot in the last 10 years and even in the last 2 years, even more. You know, I used to be, you know, the first class of YC was 6 companies and the average age of the company was 0 years, so they started that day, right? And the last batch of YC, you know, was at 80 companies and the average age was 13 months. So the role even of YC has changed dramatically. There were several people at YC that had gone to startups and then they went to YC. So when you think of your cap table and you're giving 7% to this guy and 7% to this guy, you're already giving all this money, all this part of your cap table before you get there. So, you know, you have to, if you're going to do one, I would suggest pick the right one. The other thing is there's so many incubators. I think we were joking that it's like hair, you know, like peluquerías, you know, every corner there's an incubator in this place. So, you know, you really, it's very easy to set up an incubator, just put it up, it's not so much money, people come, but it's more important to pick the right incubator. So again, going back to your first investors, it's so important to pick the right one. If you pick YC, you're definitely gonna have a higher chance. Not everybody.
If they pick you,
you get into YC or whatever, you have a higher chance of getting a higher valuation seat on average. I mean, we've done all the numbers and it's not that 100% of people get it, but you have a higher chance. I mean, the number two is way far from YC in terms of the average valuations. So, you know, and the people that attend the demo days, you go to YC, you have partners at Andreessen Horowitz, partners at Sequoia, you go to any other incubator, it's the associates. So, you know, there's a big difference in incubators, one to another. So, if you can, go to the one that's going to help you. Maybe boutique ones, right? If you're doing hardware, you can do a hardware one. If you're doing, you know, Bitcoin, I think there might be one in Bitcoin. I don't know, but I guess maybe somebody's going to put it up. So, you know, that's my take on current incubators. And they can certainly help people, especially if you're not familiar with the U.S., right? If I was just coming from Spain and I didn't know anything, I certainly would want to go to one, come up to speed quickly.
Are we enough?
You were going to tell a little bit of the story of this company. Weren't you going to tell the story of...
I think he told the story. I think he told it at the beginning. I think people are...
Okay.
Maybe catch up afterwards. Right. I think, yeah, right? Thank you very much. Thank you. Wonderful.